Thank you very much. Thanks for coming to the session. As John said, Paul Suarez, VP and CISO for Casey's, or Casey's General Stores, a convenience store chain in the Midwest. If you're not familiar with Casey's, headquarters in Des Moines, Iowa, which is where I came in from, 2,400 stores, got about 40,000 employees, and we're in 16 states. However, this presentation is about cybersecurity at scale that's much larger than that. So it'll leverage heavily my experience at Walmart, where I was a CISO for Walmart International before I took this job, and informed by time I had in the US Air Force when I was the Director of Air Force Network Operations and as such had responsibility for the entirety of the Air Force network. So the scale I'm talking about is hundreds of thousands of devices, multiple continents with numbers of countries that your company represents. Because I believe the challenge gets exponentially larger as companies get larger and you add complexity because you'll have acquisitions, you might have wholly owned subsidiaries, other operating models for part of your footprint. So this presentation is designed to help you attack that. Disclaimer, these are my opinions and my experience, not that of the RSA conference or my current or former employers, but you guys probably know that. And I like using this quote as the start. Do you know your unknowns? For two reasons. One is, when I read this, and this was Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld in the lead up to the Iraq War in 2003, and he had this quote that obviously had a lot of media quoting him and wondering what he meant. And his real purpose for the quote is, there are unknown things that you don't know about that trip up countries when you make decisions like going to war. But I got from it, you know what, that may be true, but in cybersecurity, it's the known things that I might not know about that's gonna trip me up. So I believe that it's the things you should know about that you don't know about that is the challenge within cybersecurity, your known unknowns. Second reason why I like putting this up is my original title for this was Knowing the Known Unknowns, and RSA committee thought that was too Rumsfeldian, so I changed it to Know Your Environment Better Than the Enemy, which if you have a military background is Clausewitz, okay? So, but it got by them. And then I would add that when I say enemy, and I think it's probably lingua franca for us, but that's hackers, it's criminal, cyber criminal gangs, it's state-sponsored hackers, and then nation-state as well. Obviously, in my time in the Air Force, nation-state was a huge concern of ours. Now that I'm in retail, it's probably more criminal gang, but you'll have one of those four flavors, I'm sure, as your enemy. So think about that in terms of when I use that phrase. Why should you care? You're probably wondering, duh, I'm at the RSA Security Conference. Of course I care. But I like to kind of put it into context. You can see this quote where in 2015 we said $3 trillion in cybersecurity losses in that year, projected to be $10 trillion by 2025. That's a huge amount of cybersecurity loss, and if you take that $10.5 trillion expectation, the greatest transfer of wealth in human history. Said another way, if you're going to use my estimate, the estimate I saw of 2020 cybercrime at $6 trillion it costs globally, at $6 trillion, if cybersecurity was a country, it would be the world's third largest economy behind the US and China. We spend more on cybersecurity in a year than all natural disasters globally combined. Think about that. And then there is more cybersecurity damage in a year than all of the illicit drug trade globally. So it's a massive problem. And therefore, I feel like conferences like this, RSA Security Conference, are critical to helping us improve our defenses, organize, because there is a collective component to us to be able to change that narrative. I hope that based on what you're gonna learn here today, your attendance at this conference, that this projection of 2025 is not going to happen. We're going to get our arms around that, and we do that by helping and sharing with each other. Therefore, I'm here to share my experience. So here's some of the scale we're talking about. Do you have a global footprint? There's some people in the room that probably recognize this map, but obviously this company has operations in every continent save for two. Anybody know which two they don't have somebody in? Very good, yeah, Antarctica and Australia. So think about the challenges with a company that's that scale. You're in multiple continents, okay? Here's another example. And these are, quite honestly, these are pictures taken off the internet. I don't know what company this is, but they're more regional. They got Africa, Australia, Asia, the UK. I look at this and I think, the tyranny of distance. I can only imagine what it's like getting from my office in Africa over to the offices in Australia. So there's a huge challenge you have in just distance to being able to collaborate and understand what your footprint looks like. You may have one where the sun never sets. So once again, this is another picture of a taken off the internet of a company's footprint. The sun never sets on this company. So not only are you trying to get your arms around what do we have in terms of cybersecurity tools, where are we strongest, where are we weakest, you're operating 24/7, 365. And so no matter what time zone you're in, somebody's fighting the fight on a different time zone at that time on the other side of the globe. Although I would say this company at least is starting to get their arms around the challenge. You can see they know how many countries they're in, how many offices they have, and how many employees. And that's sort of the gestation of what I'm proposing in this presentation for you to be able to get your arms around with a focus on cybersecurity tools, obviously. Here's a regional one that I had to put it up just because it's North America, Europe, India, and then Roe. I'd never seen Roe before. It's the rest of the world. I love that. I don't want to be part of Roe, you know? however, when I see this, I think about what are the data security requirements in India versus in Europe? GDPR comes to mind, versus the US. Are there privacy requirements? I mentioned GDPR. So how do you handle data when you have to deal with these different geographies and their different laws and different requirements? A huge challenge. Then the last one I'm gonna use as an example is, this is a picture of what we in retail call CPGs. So there's 10 of them up here, consumer packaged goods. So they're the companies that give companies like Walmart things to sell on the shelves, companies like Casey's that we sell. Look at the spaghetti factory explosion here. You know, you have companies that have subsidiaries that have different brands within them. And when I look at this, I think beyond the fact that that's gotta be tough to get your arms around if you're one of the CPGs. Number two is, what are the command and control lines of authority? You know, if I bought a company that now we're selling and I'm Unilever, you know, do they take direction and guidance from me? Do they have their own office doing cybersecurity? You know, do we, you know, this is one of the reasons why I love my current company is when we make an acquisition, we basically remodel the place, put in the new technology, and they get absorbed into our network. That's easy. You know, I'll be honest with you, that's the easy way. This tells me that there's probably a lot more intricacies involved if you're in one of these CPGs. And then the last one I'll show is different formats. Once again, you should recognize this. There's some in the room that will very much recognize this. This is obviously Walmart. And just a subset of the different formats that they have. And so I'm using this to say the equipment that you need to secure your e-commerce platform is different than you would do for cash and carry, is different than you do for gasoline and, you know, convenience retail. And so how do you once again get an understanding of that, because each of these formats presents a different problem, a different challenge, and you probably have some flavor of that in your company. So start with the data. People would say, start with the data. Do you collect large amounts of data? You know, it may not be centralized within your cybersecurity team, but I'll bet you collect data like this. You know, this is a chart that's really, it is just data. You know, it's not compared against anything, but at least it's a place to start. You know, how many vulnerabilities are you remediating in a year? You know, how many certificates are you issuing from your certificate authority? Those all other kinds of data that's in there. So I'm showing this to say, I'll bet you the data is out there that you can gather to start understanding what it is that you have. Put another way, and this is starting to give you a sense of how you can present data. If I took that previous slide, now I distilled it down and divided it so that it's in an average minute at my company, here's what we in cybersecurity do. So once again, there's other data points. I'm very focused. I see the PCI transactions online, the PCI transactions in brick and mortar. That's me and my team on the wall, if you will, helping to protect the company. One modest proposal on how you can present that to any audience to say, in any minute of a day in our company, look at all the things that we're doing. On the flip side, I would say, if you don't have the data, find the data owner, find who has this, see if they'll share it with you, and ideally, if they would, see if you can automate it and put this in some type of dashboard that gets routinely updated. But this type of data is out there, and you can start showing what you're doing for your company and also use it as a lever point to maybe get to some sources that you don't have access to. Then how do you present it? I got all this data. I'm going to map it out with the data flows and show kind of where everything is going. I'd look at this and I'd say, is that a logical presentation or is that a physical presentation? I would submit to you, my experience has been that if you have a non-technical audience, you got to go physical. People don't understand logical unless you're in technology. But I'm not a big fan of this, you know. The other story I tell is when I was in the Air Force, we had an architect assigned to our network operations function. She had one of those printers that's, you know, the size of this desk right here. And she had one on the wall and would scribble notes and make changes, and she'd print it out again. And we'd ask her, hey, why are you doing that? She's like, well, I'm trying to capture what the network looks like. I'm like, is this correct? She's like, no, as soon as I print it, it's wrong because I know there's something else I haven't discovered yet. And I thought to myself, I know it's valuable for certain groups, but for me as a leader in that space, it wasn't really that valuable. Now, the flip side you can say is, I'm not going to worry about it. I'm going to leave my engineers to figure that out, and I'll ask them to map it out on the back of a napkin, and this is what you get, okay? I don't think leaving it up to corporate knowledge is a good approach. I will say to you that I actually have received from an acquisition a network diagram that looked somewhat close to this, believe it or not. And I said, yeah, we need a little more details, guys, but thanks for writing it down because we asked them to. They had no documentation of it before. So I've probably confused you now because you got a far-flung empire. You tell me, Paul, I'm collecting all this data, and you've told me that I got to present it somehow, but you haven't given me that solution. So I'm going to show you where to start. Easy three-step process. You know, first you figure out what's out there. How mature is it? Then you compare it against your standards. Three-step process. Everybody can remember a three-step process. So step number, I'm sorry. Here's what you're going to learn from being here. You're going to understand how to approach that challenge of collecting large amounts of data, how to filter it so that you can understand a very complex network and kind of distill it down to something that is understandable. And there's that third one, present it in an easy-to-use, digestible format that your analysts and execs can use for at-a-glance understanding. Then the last one is, how do you rate the maturity so you know where to begin, where to put your weight of effort, your resources, as you want to continuously improve. Or since I'm a PowerPoint ranger, I'm going to show you an approach. You're going to filter tons of data. You're going to know how to present it. And you're going to get a roadmap on how to know where to start. So what's out there? You have to start with your product owners. If you've gone to the agile methodology, you should have product owners for, you know, most of your areas, not unlike you see posted up here. You can group the cybersecurity service offerings in a multitude of ways. There's one proposal that you can use, but your organization may require you to go a little bit differently. There may be functional separations that require you to have maybe a network security team separate from an internet security team, and they're not part of infrastructure. But you do have to have your product owners involved if you've gone agile, because they should own that end-to-end understanding. And I think it's important for two reasons. One is they're going to help you to validate and know, yeah, that is what we have out there. Well, we've always known that that's been there. Then on the flip side, if you do have one of these large enterprises, you'll help them in understanding where might there be some capability that we didn't know about, or where do we hear that somebody went out and bought something and put it in line that we just aren't aware of that. So it becomes a symbiotic relationship when they can help you and you can help them. But start with the product owners and then figure out how you want to group the things that you're going to collect. Think about how you want to present that data. You're going to be collecting a lot of data. Here's two options: textual on the left, tabular on the right. I don't know if tabularly is a word, but it is now, exactly. I'm not a huge fan of either one of these for two reasons. The one on the left, where you put it in textually, and this is just notional. I don't know. I pulled it off the internet. The one on the left, I would suggest not using, because people don't read, okay? If you guys haven't figured that out, there's an acronym we use in the military that I've taken throughout my career called BLUF. Anybody know what the BLUF is? B-L-U-F. Bottom line up front, exactly. So when I tap out a note to my boss, the CIO or the CEO, I always start with the BLUF. Here's two lines you need to read about this thing, and then I'll have dash, 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 and then the rest of the data is below it. Because people don't read. So if you can't put it in a very concise format, don't ask them to read a whole paper that explains why you have what you have. And then the one on the right, the tabular format, it's good, but it makes me work. I have to really work and find out. There are gaps there. Does that mean we need to do something on that? Is that a good thing? Is it a bad thing? Does a check mark mean we're good to go and we don't need to do any more work? So a little bit more work involved with either of these than I would prefer. I am a pilot. I have a flying background, so I like the idea of a heads-up display or a heads-up document. Some in the room may have heard of the heads-up document. And the concept is, and this is a airliner on final, they're landing the plane, put the information that the pilot needs in front of them outside the cockpit so they don't have to look down while they're in this critical phase. And so I say, do the same thing. Get the right information in front of whether it's your engineers, your analysts, your leadership, that they can understand and don't have to take their head away from that to get a grasp of what's important. Now, the other thing I like about a heads-up display is it's customizable. And so you only see elements in that phase of flight, otherwise they're not shown. And there's two or three that I can point out to here. If anybody's curious afterwards, I can tell you. But it changes based on the phase that you're in. I think you need to do the same thing. You got to keep it concise. You got to make it filterable, and you have to let it speak for itself. I mean, I think too often if you have to explain a dashboard to somebody on your team, you've failed. If you know, every time you start talking bits and bytes and get very technical and have to explain acronyms, once again, we have failed. So I say, make it something that's at a glance, easily graspable, and it tells a story standing on its own. So I'm continuing to move on. I'm going to bring it all together. Trust me, it's all going to come together. How mature is it? You go back to these same product owners, and now you figure out, you know, how do you know how good the stuff is that's out there? How do you rate the capability? You can do it, once again, by surveying your product owners, or you can do some technical means, network scans, vulnerability tests. A red team is a great way to say, you know what, hey, can you go take a look at this? On your next red team engagement, go to this company that we bought, because here's what they say. They say they don't have any internet-facing applications or any internet-facing capabilities. You can maybe sic a red team against them. The other one that I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, it's here at RSA, and you can probably find them on the expo floor, is there are asset discovery tools that can not only give you a pretty high degree of confidence that you can find and put down on paper what you have, but I've heard of others, and at least the advertising says others that will give you a priority as well. Is there a business priority to those assets? And therefore you get a sense for, are these my crown jewels? Because I think they're over here, you know? So start with those product owners to rate the maturity again and focus on the configuration, not just the presence of the capability. You know, there's an awful lot of companies that wind up getting their names in the newspaper because they had the tool, but it really wasn't, it was in passive mode. We weren't getting the alerts to the right place. We had that one in the rack, boss, but we didn't turn it on, or we didn't activate it. It was left in my development environment, you know, that sort of thing. So to validate the configuration before you start going in and rating the maturity. So here's how I propose. I'd like to say this is my idea, but it wasn't, very heavily borrowed, had an input in it. Use color coding. Now, I'm colorblind, so I apologize to anybody that is colorblind and can't read this, but I can read these colors, I can see them, but I have the descriptions behind them. So you start with the lawn green at the top. It's a mature core capability provided by your headquarters, your center. If I say core, center, headquarters, I'm talking about your main office. You know, where does your tech team work from? And that's where you're pushing services out from. If you have somebody that is consuming those services, consider them lawn green, you know? Then you get the next level of green down. Hey, it could be an acquisition that you just bought and they're using a different endpoint solution than you have in your company. You know, they're Coke, you're Pepsi. They're CrowdStrike, you're using, you know, Palo Alto, whatever. And yet you feel like that's at a pretty good maturity level, so you give them a green as well, but it's not something you have constant automatic visibility into, nor do you have control over, so it's not where you would want everybody to be, but then again, most companies aren't gonna have the resources to make everything lawn green, you know? Then you work your way down, and here's the ones that you really gotta spend time on. It's the evolving, which is the yellow, or the undeveloped, which is the red. And I'd say whenever you start to use those colors, I'd ask you to do two things. One is validate it with that product owner. Make sure you're aligned. Hey, this capability is red. You agree with that, right? Yeah, we agree with that. And these are the reasons. Same thing with the yellow, for two reasons. One is, as soon as you start sharing this kind of thing externally, you want there to be alignment. You want people to understand that you're on message in terms of, yes, we agree, that's a red capability, and we need to get one for this business unit. The other reason is, if you show color charts in front of any leadership in your company, anybody with a C in front of their name, their title, I can tell you from experience, the first thing they want to ask about is the red and the yellows. You know, you could have an absolute panoply of green, but if you have one or two red or yellows, they're going to say, what's up with that? You know, so be aligned on it, understand what the story is behind it, so that if it needs, you know, let's say the business unit needs some resources that they just can't get, you say, hey, yeah, it's red because we don't have the resources. If you can help us get the resources, then that will become yellow. Yellow's up to green, et cetera. And then you have the blue, which is consumed, another gradation of, it's basically a third party. Once again, I'm gonna use acquisition as probably the most common example of that. I bought these guys, we haven't integrated them, and they've outsourced their SOC. It's an MSSP, therefore they're not getting SOC services from us. But it's a well-known company, you know, and so you give them a blue, you know. So the consumed is another one that helps you say this is third-party provided versus core. So what good does that do? You put it all together, and here's one way that you could show, you know, two entities in this heat map. And let's see if my pointer here works. So this one, we call it non-networked and then networked. So think about this as, you know, somebody who's connected to your core, they're pulling majority of their services from your company, your principal office. And you can see, based on the capabilities and the service groupings, pretty good. Yeah, some reds, some yellows, but a lot of green in here. And then this has to be an acquisition because they're not integrated and therefore they're using a third party. And either that's expected or it creates, you know, a room for improvement if you don't want to leave them on the third parties. So one sample way to do that. All right, so now you're starting to get an idea of the capabilities. You're getting a little bit of coloring on what's good, what's bad. How do you rate it against your standards? Once again, you start with your product owners, but when I say standards, I'm thinking PCI data security standard. I'm thinking HIPAA for health records. I'm thinking SOX. My company is PCI and SOX, Sarbanes-Oxley. So you'll know what those standards are, but sometimes you might have to, you know, introduce a product owner and say, you guys are in PCI scope. Did you know that? You know, oh, no, we didn't know that. Well, here's the requirements within that. However, what I would say is the standards that many of us have to follow will help you run a good PCI program or a SOX program, and only a subset of my systems are within scope for either of those. They don't tell me how to do my overall cybersecurity program. So you need to pick a framework that's going to be used for your overall cybersecurity program for those areas that maybe fall out of the very narrow, very specific standard that you're following. Here's some examples. You know, I'm a govy in my past, so NIST from the U.S. is a great place to start, very comfortable with that. If you're an international company, maybe it's ISO. If you're SOX, and SOX is your compliance area, COBIT's probably the thing you want to do. But there's a number of frameworks you can pick from these governing bodies. Pick the one that works best for your company. I mean, I'm in retail, so, you know, convenience store retail, so we went with NIST CSF. It's the most, I'll say, ubiquitous by this point of the frameworks, you know, and it's transferable, if you will. Everybody kind of understands it now with the five NIST areas, but one of the other frameworks may be more applicable for your company, but remember, as long as you pick a framework and somebody says, well, how does that compare to NIST CSF, Paul? There are crosswalks that says if you graded yourself against ISO, here's the things that crosswalk me into NIST CSF or vice versa. And so you shouldn't really have to do two frameworks. Pick one, crosswalk it if you need to another one, but pick the framework that works for your company. What's it gonna do for you? It's gonna tell you where you're strongest, where you're weakest, and where your areas for improvement or your biggest gaps. And then, yeah, you have to repeat it. I hate to admit it. You got to repeat it. So here's an example of, okay, now I'm starting to get this information, the data you said, Paul. We're starting to rate ourselves against the standards. I'm measuring myself against the framework. Now what do? Well, here's one way that you could plot it. And you can say the orange is where we currently are, where somebody came in. It looked like it was Q1 of 2018. Based on the legend when they rated us, but the blue indicates where you want to grow to. And so this, you know, the beauty of this is I know that, hey, I'm pretty strong in this protect and identify area, or yeah, but I probably have some work to do on here, the detect and in the recover area. You know, so now you're starting to get a sense of where does my program need to grow into. Another way to show it would be this, you know, along a line. And the gold or yellow diamond is our current company. The checkered one is where we wanna be. And then I'm also, in this one, comparing us to industries. What are the relevant industries you wanna compare yourself to? A lot of third parties will come in and give you a NIST CSF assessment. Almost all of them will be able to tell you, based on our data, here's where industries that are like yours are at. Here's where industries that might be a stretch for you are at. And then you can start to map, okay, do I wanna be best in breed, you know, best of class in all of them, or just one or two of the categories? Once again, you tie it back to your business objectives and your business needs. But another way to be able to project this, once again, a third party can do that, or there's a lot of, you know, any of the big four, you know, consulting firms, if you have any kind of relationship with them, I'm sure would be more than happy to share with you the different segments. I'm in convenience stores, so retail, transportation would be ones that I'd want to see, probably. Hospitality, if there's a one for quick service restaurant, that's something that we're in. I didn't mention Casey's Makes Pizza, too, did I? Forgot to mention that. That separates us from the rest of the convenience store chains in the world. We have pizza ovens in all of our Casey's. All right. So other than the fact that this is probably going to be you guys coming after me after this presentation, What are the priorities that you should work on? Here's how you put it all together. So I've taken a bunch of my companies on the left-hand side here, and I've mapped them across the core capabilities on the top. And let's call company A, it's my headquarters, it's my principal office, and the rest of them, you know, B through J, are acquisitions, subsidiaries, whatever have you. And when I do this, it tells me two things. One is, whatever company is I, they got some work to do. That's where this segment needs some help, okay? Clearly, you can see that. And also, I need to do some work in my incident management space if I'm the head of the cybersecurity program, because we're kind of green up here, but we're not pushing the services very solidly to the rest of the entity, the rest of the enterprise. So here's one way that you can put this together. I'll talk about it in a little bit. I would not recommend showing the whole thing to other business unit leaders. I cherry pick the ones that you want them to compete against, because you could find yourself spending a lot of time describing this. Like I said, there's some in the team here at Walmart that work with me. This was sort of internal. We didn't usually push this out externally because it helped us to know we got to dig in a little bit deeper, as I showed, you know, on this one and in this area here. Once again, notional. This is not a representation of anything. So you have that. Now, how do you continuously improve? Stick to those priorities. If we agree that it's red, it's red, you know, and stick to that. And your business may accept that, but you say, hey, then we have to go through a risk acceptance process or something like that. Make sure you're aligned with the business. You know, don't assume you're going to be green and everything, because no business is going to support that. And then you help decide in conjunction with the business goals, what are the things that, you know, that we may not be best of breed at. Revisit the ratings with those product owners. You got to do it at least annually, I'll say from experience. Every 6 months seemed about the right frequency. A little more than that, and you'd kind of wear them out, you know. A little bit less, and some significant changes would happen, and you might lose, for instance, let's say a budget cycle when you could have an opportunity to get more resources. And then measure, share, and compare your results. Like I said, a little competition is a great motivator, so I wouldn't show that full color chart that I showed you, but I might cherry pick and say, hey, company B, here's how you compare with company D. Did you know your buddy down the road is all green over here and you're not? Well, what? You know, and once again, as long as you're aligned with the product owners and they know that you're presenting to leadership of that company, it can help you. Rank ordering, hey, one through however, you know, one through N, here's how we're doing, either in the service groups or overall. That works too. Nobody wants to be at the bottom of any list. I don't care what the list is. It's human nature. We don't want to be the tail end Charlie, as I would call it from my last life. And then I didn't use any acronyms, so I got to throw some acronyms in there, the OODA or PDCA. OODA, somebody help me out. OODA. There you go. Observe, Orient, Decide, Act. Comes from the Air Force. PDCA. Really? Oh, you're kidding me. Plan, Do, Check, Act. Somewhat similar. Okay. Here's how you're going to apply what you learned today. Next week. And I mean this. You know, we're talking the 13th of June. Identify the data sources at your disposal. And how you can start to describe your environment. What are those sources that you have that you can tap into right now? And my caution is, don't wrap yourself around the axle trying to invent new data sources or get data. It exists already. You already collect. That was why I showed you that. You have it. Tap into that. 3 months from now, think about the framework you're going to use. You can almost say, you know, NIST CSF can be the default, but is another framework more appropriate for your business? Start assembling the types of questionnaires. Questionnaires can be kind of a drag, you know, and so maybe there's some questions that you can filter out when you do start engaging with the product owners. And once again, verify or identify those product owners so that it's kind of like a preparatory command. They know it's coming, because it's going to be more work for them. It'll be work for them, but the benefit should outweigh the amount of effort that they're going to do. But have a relationship with them, and if it's not product owners, find the functional managers in charge of these cybersecurity core services so that they know my engineers or my managers are going to have to be doing some additional work, but it should work out, once again, collaboratively for both sides. And then 6 months, start doing the surveys. Start contacting those product owners and collecting what they have. Decide how you want to show the data. The color charts is one idea. You could do the graph. You could do the scatter diagram. And begin plotting it. Begin plotting to see where do we need to improve? Where do we need to grow into? Because we might not be where we want to be based on the segments that we're comparing ourselves to. Then you will know your environment better than the enemy. All right. Questions? How'd I do on time, John?
You did great.
Okay. Somebody's going to have to, all right, somebody from Walmart better ask me a question.
Is there any fighting in the war room? is this presentation available?
Yeah, I think they posted it on the website, yes?
All right, there was one I went to earlier today and it was already there, so I didn't know if that was just...
I'm pretty sure it's there already.
All right, I'll check, thanks.
That's it, okay.
Yep, that was it.
Other questions?
How you doing?
Good.
My question is, as you absorb all this information, what is the format with which you document and store it and report it to others?
Spreadsheets, I hate to admit. And it was a bit of a challenge to keep it up to date, which is why if you let it set for more than 6 months, it became kind of a heavy lift to update. But you also want to make sure that what you're collecting, your product owners are aligned on too. I mean, because one of the things we also did at Walmart was, in addition to having the color chart, I did have a table that had the specific standards that we were measuring each particular area against. And as long as you had agreement on that, it came easy to revisit. If you didn't agree on what the standards are, then that revisit was a heavy lift. Does that make sense? Okay. Other questions? Who from Walmart's going to ask me a question?
What's your favorite pizza?
My favorite pizza? Veggie pizza. Brian, I'm trying to watch my weight. Yeah, breakfast pizza is pretty good. We do make breakfast pizza. Other questions? All right. Well, thanks, everybody, for attending. I appreciate it.